سلام عليكم. بفرما بزرگوار. بفرما. Go ahead. Who is this? سلام عليكم. Yes. What can I do for you?
Yes. This is Salman from the United
States. Salman, turn off your TV. Mute your TV, please. First. Go ahead.
Okay. Yeah. Let me turn it down. Hold on. Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Go ahead.
Okay. Perfect. Yes, I had a question. This is regarding, I guess there's two parts. Number one is regarding whenever the Sunnis, they always tell us that what did Muhammad Ali do in terms of why didn't he defend Sayyidina Fatima Zahra about that. You know, I know that we have stuff in Kitab Sulaim, but besides that, is there any other proof about what he did and how was he vengeful towards Umar and the rest of them who were with him?
Brilliant. Okay. You got to hear me from TV, okay?
Yeah, perfect.
Okay, thank you so much. Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam, did he defend Zahra salamullahi alayha or he did not defend salamullahi alayha? Of course, what you refer to in the Book of Sulaim, and I put, here's the Book of Sulaim, Ibn Qais, that's very important to refer to. Because Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam did not kill Umar. And did not pull sword against Umar, and there's a reason for that, and I'm going to explain that. However, he did beat Umar. I'm going to show you that text and some other texts, inshallah, and it's going to be sufficient proof for you in the future whenever you need to speak and debate the opponents. This is the Book of Sulaim ibn Qais Hilali. Printed in Qom. Printed in Qom. The matba'a is here. Kitab Sulaim ibn Qais al-Hilali. Intisharat al-Dalilima. Page number 586. فوثب علي عليه السلام فأخذ بتلابيبه ثم نطره فصرعه وجعنته ورقبته. Amir al-Mu'mineen عليه الصلاة والسلام sprang up and grabbed Umar from his waist and lifted him up and hit him on the ground. Slammed him on the ground. وَوَجَى أَنْفَهُ وَرَقَبَتَهُ And inflicted pain on his nose and on his neck. وَهَمَّ بِقَتْلِهِ And intended to kill him. فَذَكَرَ قَوْلَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَالِهِ وَمَا أَوْصَاهُ بِهِ He remembered then after immediately he remembered the saying of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam and his wasiyah to him, his final will to him. فَقَالَ وَالَّذِي كَرَّمَ مُحَمَّدًا بِالنُّبُوَّةِ يَبْنَ السُّحَاكِ قَالَ أَمِيرُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ said, I take an oath by that Allah who gave prophethood to our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, لَوْلَا كِتَابُ مِنَ اللَّهِ سَبَقْ If there was not an order from Allah تبارك وتعالى to me, وَأَحْدٌ أَحِدَهُ إِلَيَّ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ And there was not an allegiance and a commitment that I have committed to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. لَعَلِمْتَ أَنَّكَ لَا تَدْخُلُ بَيْتِي If it was not for that, you would have known that you would never were able to enter my house. So Amir al-Mu'mineen عليه الصلاة والسلام defended Zahra salamullahi alayha and hit Umar but did not kill Umar. This is from our sources. Amma, however, from the Umari sources, it is, they have themselves in many, many traditions, they have narrated from the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam that it is prohibited, it's haram, it's forbidden to raise a sword against the rulers, even if they are inherently and fully against the sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, and they are hypocrites and they are munafiq and they do all sorts of oppression. For instance, look at this riwayat in Muslim, Sahih Muslim, by Hafiz Muslim al-Hajjaj al-Qushayri, printed in Darul Fikr in Beirut in the year 432 from Hijrah. This is the Kitab of Imara, Kitab al-Imara, باب الأمر بلزوم الجماعة عند ظهور الفتن. This chapter pertains to adherence to unity, adherence to the congregation when mischiefs rise. The number of the narration is 4,678, counting the repetitions. Without the repetitions, 1,847. And in most prints of Muslim, you would see the second numeration that has been considered. That's the numeration without counting the repeated narrations. 1,847. Yarwi, he narrates on the authority of Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman. Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman. قال عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم the Nabi صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم said يكون بعدي أئمة لا يهتدون بهداي. After me, there will be rulers. There will be rulers, imams, rulers, caliphs. لا يهتدون بهداي. They will not be guided by my guidance. They لا يهتدون بهداي. They will not be guided by my guidance. ولا يستنون بسنتي. Nor they would be following my sunnah. وسيقوم فيهم رجال. And amongst them will stand men. Will stand men amongst them. قلوبهم قلوب الشياطين. Their hearts will be the hearts of Satan's. قلوبهم قلوب الشياطين. Their hearts, they'll not be only hypocrites. They will not be only kafir. No, worse. Their hearts would be the hearts of Satan's. Satan's. Perhaps Satan is not pluralized in English. However, here, shayateen, I have to pluralize it. قلوبهم قلوب الشياطين. Their hearts would be the hearts of Satan's. في جثمان إنس. And the bodies of human beings. And the bodies of human beings. Their souls, their spirits. Their hearts would be the hearts of shaitan. However, their appearance, their bodies, they would be in the form of human being. So these words are you cannot express the deprivation and the degradation and the mischievous nature of those caliphs after the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in words more expressive than these. قلوبهم قلوب الشياطين في جثمان إنس. قال قلت كيف أصنع يا رسول الله إن أدركت ذلك. حذيفة ابن اليمان says I said يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم what should I do if should I see those times if I should see those times. فقال قال النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم تسمع وتطيع للأمير وإن ضرب ظهرك وأخذ مالك فاسمع وأطع. You will obey and you will listen to the Amir, even if he hits your back, lashes your back, or he takes your property. فَاسْمَعْ وَأَطَعْ. Listen and obey. So, or it could be read another way. وَإِنْ ضُرِبَ ضَحْرُكَ وَأُخِذَ مَالَكَ. Obey and listen to the commander, even if your back is lashed with a cane or with a durra, وَأُخِذَ مَالُكَ, or your property is taken away from you, listen and follow, listen and obey. So therefore, Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman passed away during the caliphate of Uthman ibn Affan. He did not see the caliphs afterwards, من بني Umayyah, Muawiyah, Yazid, Marwan ibn al-Hakam, or Bani Abbas. He died, passed away in the caliphate of Uthman. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not say to Hudhayfa, no, Hudhayfa, you will not be then, you will not be alive then. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, do not rise up. Rather, even if your property is taken, even if you're oppressed, even if you're beaten up, do not rise up. If that is the command of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not to rise against oppressive caliphs, even if they are so much kafir, so much so that their hearts are the hearts of Satan, only their bodies, their figures, their appearance is the appearance of human beings. Therefore, if Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam did not rise up with sword against Abi Bakr and Umar, that means he did not commit a haram according to the Sunni faith, according to the wasiyyat of the Nabi, of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which they have narrated in their own most authentic books. Therefore, to ask why did not Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salatu wasalam commit a haram, this question is absurd. Na'am, yes, if he had committed something against the command of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's legitimate to ask, why did he commit such a thing? Because it's forbidden. However, if it was performed, what he did conforms to the wasiyah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and what the Nabi, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, asked and commanded, then obedience to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not a blame to be. So someone could ask, what's the reason for, and what is the justification of his action? Also, this matter is in many other books of Al-Umariyyah. For instance, I show you this riwayah min Sunan Abi Dawood. هذا سنن أبي داود السجستاني للحافظ أبي داود سليمان بن الأشعث السجستاني طبع دار الفكر طبع سنة 1426 في دار الفكر في بيروت printed in year 1426 in دار الفكر. And you know that Abu Dawood is one of the most famous and reliable and respected Umari scholars of narration and tradition. In this book, he narrates on the authority of Abu Dharr, Ridwanullahi Tabarak wa Ta'ala alayh, Abu Dharr in al-Ghifari. كتاب السنة باب في قتل الخوارج. The killings of خوارج. That's the name of the chapter. However, there is no mention of خوارج in the hadith. So the hadith is not particularly related to خوارج. Hadith is general, as you will see the text of the hadith. Although he brought it under this chapter, however, the hadith is general. It's not specific to the killing of خوارج. 4759, page number 891. عن أبي ذر قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله كيف أنتم وأئمة من بعدي يستأثرون بهذا الفيء. أبو ذر says, said the Nabi صلى الله عليه وآله, how would you be, how would you behave, what is going to be your condition? You will see after me imams or rulers who will يستأثرون بهذا الفيء. Who will do what? Who will غنائم. فيء is the غنيمة in war. The booties of the war, the Baytul Mal of Muslims, the treasury of the Muslims. Rulers who would usurp the treasury of the Muslims. They would take the money that belongs to the poor of the Muslim, to the, all the Muslims, they would take it and use it for their own personal gains. How would you do? How would you behave? قلت أبو ذر سيد إذن والذي بعثك بالحق أضع سيفي على آتقي ثم أضرب به حتى ألقاك أو ألحقك. I said, I take an oath by that Allah who sent you as a prophet with the truth that I will put my sword on my shoulder and I will fight them until I die and until I meet you and until I join you in the hereafter. قال أولا أدلك على خير من ذلك. نبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, Abu Dharr, should I show you a pathway that's better than fighting, that is better than taking your sword out and fighting those people, those rulers. قَالَ تَصْبِرُ حَتَّى تَلْقَانِي. You have to bear patience until you pass away, until you die, and until you join me in the hereafter. And Abu Dharr died in the during the reign of Uthman. So these narrations, they prove what? They prove that according to their own narrations from the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's haram. It's forbidden. It's prohibited to rise up with sword against the rulers, even if they are kafir, even if they are munafiq, even if they are oppressive. This is according, based on their own narrations. According to our narrations, it's not like that. According to our narrations, it's the Imam Ma'soom, the infallible Imam. If he rises up, it's his choice, and he does not do so, but by the command of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And if he sees that he has enough supporters, enough armies, that his rise is justified because he can wage war against the enemy, then he rises up. It's his choice, his determination, his discretion. And if he decides no, that the harm of rising up is more than its benefits, and he decides not to rise up and pull out the sword, then he does not pull out the sword. Then again, it's his discretion. His discretion is the discretion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he's never mistaken. In the book of Usul al-Kafi, Hunalika Abwab, there are chapters that Aimma alayhim as-salatu wa-salam don't do anything by the command of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Unburu, please pay attention. This is Usul min al-Kafi lil-Kulayni Ridwanullahi tabarak wa ta'ala. Dar al-Kutub al-Islamiyya. Bali, volume number one. In this book, أن الأئمة عليهم السلام لا يفعلون شيئا إلا بأمر من الله تبارك وتعالى. بلي. There's a chapter that أئمة عليهم السلام do everything they do by the command of Allah تبارك وتعالى. بلي. بل أن الأئمة عليهم السلام لا يفعلون شيئا إلا بعهد من الله. Page number 279. كتاب الحجة. Page 279. الأئمة عليهم الصلاة والسلام لم يفعلوا شيئا ولا يفعلون إلا بعهد من الله عز وجل. الأئمة عليهم الصلاة والسلام, the Imams صلوات الله عليهم, they do not do anything, do not take any action, or do not do not maintain inaction. Inaction. I-N-A-C-T-I-O-N. Inaction. Do not act and do not remain stagnant except for the command of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Their inaction is by the command of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And all their actions are by the command of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And he mentions several traditions here. In one of these traditions, and that's the third one in this bab, in this chapter, sorry, the fourth one over there, أن الله, that Allah تبارك وتعالى, he sent Jibreel, Mikael, and other angels right before the demise of the Nabi صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم, and those angels came with a message from Allah تبارك وتعالى to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم and to Amir al-Mu'minin عليه الصلاة والسلام to take a commitment from Amir al-Mu'minin عليه السلام and get a promise from Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salatu wasalam that he will not rise with sword after the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam passes away and his house is attacked by the Sahaba. And that narration is here. You can read it. It's more than one page long, so I don't have time right now to read it and translate it for you. You can refer there and read it there. So this was by, according to us, to our perspective and our narrations, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala took a pledge from Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salatu wasalam and take a solemn commitment from him that he will not rise up after the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when his house is attacked. So therefore Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salatu wasalam honored that commitment and did not rise with a sword. This is our perspective. So he did what was required to, from him from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. According to Umari perspective, again his inaction and the fact that he did not rise with a sword against Abu Bakr and Umar and did not fight them, that's also according to them. It's according to the sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Therefore, the justification that Umar is present in defense of Umar, why Amir al-Mu'min alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not fight, this justification is very absurd. This defense only convinces the fools. The truth of the matter is that attacking the house of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, attacking the house of Zahra salamullahi alayha, no kufr in the world can be worse and more repugnant than that. It's obvious. Now Amir al-Mu'min alayhi sallam does not rise with a sword. And you, may I refer you to the Quran al-Kareem in Surah Hud. In Surah Hud and al-Quran al-Kareem, بلي أو سورة الشعراء أو in the you can refer that to the story of Lot. Lot alayhi salam, kuffar attack his house, enter his house by force, and Lot alayhi salatu wasalam does not fight them back. So it's the sunnah of anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam from before that at certain times they did not fight back. Therefore this justification is very, very, very weak. If it signifies anything, it signifies the kufr of Abu Bakr and Umar, because they attacked the house of Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam, the house of Zahra salamullahi alayha. Thank you so much.